Good morning, St. Jacobs.
Good morning.
Thank you for coming out this morning. It's great to see all of you. For those of you who didn't make it yesterday, we did Wreaths Across America here in the cemetery. Very nice ceremony, good turnout. It's just wonderful to see the wreaths with the red ribbons now all over the cemetery on both sides of the street. It was 238 veterans that we put wreaths on their tombstones yesterday. Thank you everyone who participated. Thank you everyone who contributed. All our wreaths were paid for, so that was wonderful this year also. Okay, after church today, we do have a consistory meeting. So consistory members, please remember to stay afterwards. Yes, Catherine, I'm looking at you. Next Sunday, on the 24th, we do have a 10:30 service here in our church, normal Sunday service. Then at 6 o'clock, we have a candlelight service across the street at the Lutheran Church with our brothers and sisters over there. So please come out for both services. December 31st, we will have a combined service here at 10 o'clock, which, as it has in here, will just be lessons and carols. But if you can come out for that one, it'll be a good time for us to get together again. Other announcements. Bob?
No. Food pantry on Saturday.
Yes, that's true. We have food pantry coming up again next Saturday. All right, and I'll turn it over to Bob to get things started.
Comforts all who mourn, and gives them immortal praise instead of a faint spirit.
rejoicing always, praying without ceasing, holding fast to what is good.
We are witnesses to the light of Christ.
Our opening hymn is number 156.
Thank you.
this victory wreath that marks our days of preparation for Christ's advent. As we light the candles on this wreath, strengthen our hearts as we await the Lord's coming in glory. Enlighten us with your grace that we may serve our neighbors in need. Grant this through Christ our Lord, whose coming is certain and whose day draws near.
Amen.
Our first lesson is taken from the 61st chapter of Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be made known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are the people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exalt in my God. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second lesson is taken from 1 Thessalonians, the 4th chapter. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise the words of the prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every evil. May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And the Holy Gospel according to John, the 1st chapter. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" And he said to them, "I am not. Are you a prophet?" He said, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" And he said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They ask him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The Gospel of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
There is much more to life than meets the eye. There is more in our past than history can tell. There is more going on in the present moment than we know. There is more in our relationships with one another than we are aware. And the more we explore the mystery of our lives, the more we learn about ourselves. The more mysterious ourselves become. Seldom have we been content with what appeared on the surface. We know there is more. Seldom have we felt fully at ease in the present moment, sensing, however, incoherently, that no matter how full our present, beyond the now, there is more. We tend, if left to our own devices, toward reductionism. We ought to be exploring possibilities, enriching our sense of what is known, cultivating wonder. Again, if left to our own devices, we reduce the cosmos to the periodic table. We explain human history by reducing it to two or three factors: the six causes of the Civil War, the main reason for the Great Depression, 30 true false statements explaining the 18th century. In our better moments, when delivered from our own devices, when the modern analytic gives way to the eternal poetic, we know there's more. When life is reduced to technique, six easy steps toward sure success, flattened to a series of problems to be solved, we become numb, anti-sensitized against either real pain or true pleasure. The body adjusts, in the absence of expectation, to its cage. But occasionally, sometime, someone manages to hit a nerve, and we, twitching slightly, discomfort, suspect that there just may be more. The audience for this Advent text from Isaiah are the afflicted, the brokenhearted, the captive, those in prison, and mourners. In short, your average congregation. The people whom these words are addressed are those who come to church out of sometimes barely felt, sometimes fervently burning hope for more. The words also speak, though we do not know how they will hear, to those who have stopped coming to church because they have given up hoping or anything else. Isaiah says that God has intervened, that God has anointed one to take action. That action announced is political: release to the prisoners, reparation for the ruined cities, justice. The intervention is announced by the poetical. It's just poetry here. Poetry with dangerous for the establishment, that is, political repercussions. The year of the Lord, which Isaiah announces, is Jubilee time, when everything to which the established political order would have us adjust is turned upside down, set right, and the devastated, empty streets of downtown are transformed into a great festival. When we were slaves in Egypt, God intervened and brought us out. We badly learned to be content with our lot in Egypt, at least in slavery. Our masters gave us 3 square meals a day. But God intervened. He led us toward more. Intervention is needed again. Some decisive intrusion which will enable new life and halt our march toward death. Israel and church struggle to describe the intervention. Exodus, Bethlehem, Calvary, the upper room, the empty tomb. Without intervention, then, there is no hope. There is no hope for more. And thank God, because there is God, in circumstances of the worst brokenhearted, captivity, imprisonment, and mourning, there is always more. Isaiah speaks of a world beyond present arrangements, a world where there is good news, liberty, comfort, garlands instead of ashes. This is biblical apocalyptic Bible talk about the more beyond the now. It is daring. It is poetic, politically significant speech. Speech pushed to the boundaries in the description of what God is breaking open among us. Breaking open in dusty, little, out-of-the-way places like Bethlehem. Isaiah's words refuse to abide with confines of rationality, of the dominant society. Refuses to be limited by common sense, everyday experience. It was Isaiah who taught Mary to sing apocalyptically, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. He has scattered the proud, he has put down the mighty from their thrones, he has exalted the low degree, he has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty." When we come to church and are exposed to such speech from Isaiah or Mary, we are beckoned out beyond the world of predictability into another world of thought and risk and gift, in which divine intervention enables new life to break our prosaic reduction, to subvert our tamed expectations, and to evoke fresh faith. Dangerous hope leads to daring resistance. Docility is no longer possible for those who hear tell of more. Being interviewed on television, a group of Soviet Christian dissidents was asked by a reporter, "Well, what do you want? Why aren't Soviet Christians satisfied with the new freedoms which Gorbachev has given? Why won't you now soften your criticism and support of the government?" The Christian dissident responded, and the translator explained, "He says they are not satisfied. He says they always want more." Anything less is a trap and a delusion. Sunday at its best is a summons toward more, but not just any old more. Our vague, frequently reoccurring, gnawing sense of need, which we so often attempt to assuage by more mere buying, accumulating, getting and giving, particularly at this time of year, is articulated and reformed by the prophet. as a groping after God and God's will. The more we desire is given a name, named the year of the Lord's favor. The year in which God gets what God wants, when earth more closely resembles that which God first had in mind when God began forming nothing into something, less into more. Poetic, apocalyptic, prophetic speech as that of Isaiah or Mary, or an Advent hymn, doesn't just describe the world. It recreates. It makes a world. It is a world made open with old, comfortable certitudes broken by the advent of our God, who makes all things new. In the world where God comes, we are allowed to roam, to redecide. Here is the poetic imagination assaulting ideology, new configurations of life yet unformed, unthought, undreamed, now available. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Good tidings to the afflicted, the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to give them a garland instead of ashes. Here is Isaiah's protest against religion reduced to slogan, morals, five fundamentals, bumper sticker proverbs, thoughts for the day, religion regulated to the conventional, the boring rehash of the obvious and the already known. Here is the protest against Sunday as adjustment to what is seen rather than probing what is more. We come to church for certitude, to touch base with the known. But the apocalyptic speech does not give certitude. In the poetic, apocalyptic, spirit or anointed space, possibility overwhelms necessity in life, and we can breathe. So we go forth after church. There are the same quarrels in the car on the way home, the same tensions over the dinner table, same blue Monday. But now, however, we are aware of a new world, a new hope, a new possibility, new dreams, new hunger for something else. In short, we are aware of more. We see how greatly reduced, how tamed has been our truth. We who have tasted new wine now thirst for more. The Prince of Darkness whispers, adjust, adapt. The Prince wants us to keep the world closed, for a closed world is easier to administer, and people without a future are more manageable than people with imagination. Sometimes on Sundays when we gather, the prince rules the roost. No new thing is uttered or heard. The pulpit is the place of the platitude and the comfortable cliches, the proverbs and the slogans, and nothing more. But sometimes on a cold Sunday in December, we peek over the horizon and stand on our tiptoes with Isaiah, and we see more. More than we dared to accept. Somebody goes home from church, newly disconnected with the present arrangements, hungry for more. Someone gets ready for more than just another Christmas. Advent becomes adventure. And we dare to wish for ourselves more, more for our world, more for others. And Isaiah laughs and Mary smiles. Poetry has carried the day against prose. And the prince knows that he has lost a little of his territory to its true Lord and Savior. Savior. The Lord's newly reclaimed territory is you. The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Maybe you've heard about the man in a depressed region of Appalachia, a coal miner out of work for months, who caught his children on the back porch thumbing through a Sears catalog, wishing. He flew into a rage, switched their legs, tore the catalog to bits, and sat down in his yard and wept. Did you read in the Bible about the young woman in a depressed region of Judea, a poor, unmarried mother-to-be who was caught wishing for more, singing, "My soul magnifies the Lord, for he has done great things. He has shown strength. He has scattered the proud. He has put down the mighty and exalted to those of low degree. He has filled the hungry with good things." Amen. Hymn number 152. Thank you. in our own hearts. It is God alone who gives life, who is generous beyond measure, with grace and blessing. We follow Jesus, whom God sent to teach and heal, to show us a new way of living, with love and trust and courage, with joy and generosity. In this faith, Jesus gave himself, even his very life. He was crucified and buried, yet God raised him from death and lives among us and grants his Spirit to us. We live by that Holy Spirit and entrust ourselves to his guidance and empowerment. As members of the Church, the body of Christ, we devote ourselves to lives of love, rejoicing in the power of forgiveness, the reality of the resurrection, and the mystery of eternal life. Amen. You may be seated. With hope and expectation, we offer our prayers for the Church, the world, and all who await God's day of restoration. Fill our mouths with laughter and our tongues with shouts of joy, as we bear witness to the great things you have done. Give your Church, especially St. Jacob's Lutheran and St. Jacob's UCC, a spirit of gladness as we gather and as we are sent. Merciful God,
receive my prayers.
Let the trees of the field sing your praise. Protect forests, orchards, rainforest, and all wooded areas from disease and deforestation. Keep us grateful for their gifts of oxygen, food, shade, and shelter. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You love justice and promise your favor to those who are oppressed, brokenhearted, and incarcerated. Grant wisdom and compassion to those who work for public safety and all who work within prisons, jails, and courts, that mercy may increase and violence wither away. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
Give us strength to pray for our world without ceasing, and provoke us toward love and good deeds for all who are in need. Provide for all without adequate housing, food, employment, or access to health care. Empower us as helpers and advocates. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Open our hearts to those who serve as truth tellers in our Church and in our society. Bless leaders in the Church and society in their tasks of proclamation. Amplify voices of peacemakers, advocates, and especially those whose voices are ignored or marginalized. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
With gratitude, we rejoice in the saints who witnessed to your life in all circumstances, in whom your Spirit was not quenched even in death. Through them, teach us always to hold fast for what is good. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Listen to these and all our prayers, O God of hosts, and restore us with your great and everlasting mercy, through Jesus Christ, on whose birth we await and taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please rise and join me in our last hymn, number 179.
Thank you.
now